everybody, welcome to Guitar in the Real World. This week I've got a slightly more obscure track from the great Al Jarreau, and it features two guitarists on it. Nile Rodgers produced the record, so he's playing on it, but also he features Hiram Bullock on rhythm guitar too, and he also does a couple of solo breaks as well. So, two greats of the rhythm guitar world in one track. What more could you ask for? This tune is called Give a Little More Lovin', and it's from Ellie's for Lover, which was Jarreau's 1986 release, which kind of bombed, I think. Sank without a trace. According to Wikipedia, Nile Rodgers said it's the best thing he ever made that didn't sell. I chose this track, though, just because it's a good example of two rhythm guitar parts working together, and the solo isn't that hard, but it does exactly the right thing. You know, it's a kind of a soul pop track with a big soaring lead guitar break from Hiram in the middle. He also does some outro stuff. Nile's part is pretty straightforward. He's essentially just adding a kind of a slightly rhythmic pad to the texture. There's the X7 electric piano providing a lot of the kind of mid-range harmony. So Nile's using, I think, position 2 on the Strat, the classic, classic clean sound there with a bit of chorus, and he essentially plays in the kind of verse sections and the intro, which is a sort of a truncated version of that. He just sort of plays this E minor 7 to A minor 7 thing that goes like this. 3, 4. Through those two chord changes there. So yeah, I mean, there's nothing particularly groundbreaking about this. In the chorus section, he plays C to D like this. 3, 4. Short, and then leaves a gap for another bar and a half, then does the same thing again, but that's a D over E now, and then we get the chord moves, and then we're back into the, there's that little long train running movement occurs occasionally. Now, as with all these rhythm parts, there is variation throughout the song. This is basically what happens in the first verse. Beyond that, he develops what he plays as the song develops as well. One worth taking note of, actually, is the way that the drums and bass develop throughout the song. It's Steve Ferroni and Anthony Jackson on this, so you couldn't really ask for a better pairing than those two. And there's a lot of interplay between the drums and bass anyway, but the way that the energy builds and the busyness and the delivery builds for the final kind of chorus, especially in the drums, there's a lot more aggressive hi-hat, sort of, he's laying into the hi-hat more, and AJ's playing more lower register stuff and just filling out a bit more. I didn't bother recording the whole thing, I just did the one kind of verse and chorus thing to do this for today. But it's a good track from a arrangement point of view, I think. It's much more organic than a lot of the tracks on the rest of the album as well, because it's one of the two tracks where we have real bass on it. Okay, Hiram's part. I think his rhythm part is played on the middle pickup, which is something that he used to do a lot, actually. So notice I have the correct colour and vintage style Strat for this. It's all about the colour to get the right kind of Hiram sound. I don't think there's any chorus on this rhythm part. If there is, it's very, very subtle. So Hiram plays in the intro section. He plays 3, 4, 1, 2. 1. I think they're the voicings he uses. It's a little bit cloudy. So he's playing this funky picking thing muted high up here. In the next section, which is the chorus, He plays kind of in the gaps, answering the main stabs that Nile plays. So he plays this, after the stabs, you get this 1, 2, 3. So it's just a nice little subtle funky picking line. In the verse, he does very similar to the intro, which is this thing. 3, 4, 1, 2. He repeats that again. And in the sort of pre-chorus, both Hiram and Nile play these chords, which is that's like a D triad to an E minor triad, but it's over a C, so it's D over C to C major 7th. Before hitting the F major 7th, then C over D, and I think Hiram definitely plays that high voicing there. C add 9 voicing, common thing to do if you've got a C over D. It highlights the, if you play the high D, it's the root note on the top, but it highlights the sound of that kind of sus 4 thing. And that's essentially what happens. Like I say, there's variation in both parts, but this is the bare bones of it. When it goes into the guitar solo, Hiram's rhythm part, he's just playing backbeats. Really simple stuff, just over the E minor to A minor. All right, let's talk about the solo. This solo, it's basically blues, E minor pentatonic, E minor position 1, he goes up the neck, does a minor third bend in the middle of it, but essentially it's pretty straightforward stuff. It's doing the right kind of job. You know, you wouldn't want to be playing anything that's too out, or it's as much about the attitude really, so the bluesy kind of soulful attitude. So let's just talk through each phrase. So I've engaged my Hiram tone, my Hiram lead tone. Quick note about the sound here. I've been using my Axe 8 for all these videos, as would be the most obvious thing in this day and age. But I found the best way to replicate Hiram's lead tone was to, I used a sort of Fender Twin model with some chorus and delay. And going into that, I'm using a Boss Super Overdrive with medium amount of gain. And before that, I've got an SP compressor. And I think the compressor really contributes to the Hiram sound, whether he's playing clean or distorted. His tone was never really that abrasive. It was more about the sustain than to get tons rather than getting a particularly gainy sound. I think he was trying to get a sustainy sound. So I haven't got it exactly right, but it's in the ballpark. Anyway, so what we get. The solo starts with this simple E minor blues kind of thing. He goes, the first phrase is this, 3, 4. First phrase, second phrase, 1, 2, 3. The next phrase is 1, 2. So after all that bluesy stuff, you get the melody underneath Al, because he comes back in singing at that point. Then you get this, which is kind of over the F chord, Lydian sound. And then we get this thing, which is 1. Just a kind of up the E minor scale. That's the only time it really gets scalic. So within the actual bulk of the solo, he occasionally hits the 9th, the F sharp, but basically he's just playing very bluesy ideas. You've got that big minor third bend there. With a bit of a position shift there, I think that's probably how he plays it. Okay, so as with all these, check out the original recording. It's always worth listening to the original to really get the flavour of how it's all supposed to sound. If you're not familiar with Hiram Bullock's work, he was a big name on the New York session scene in the 70s and 80s and 90s. Sadly died about 10 years ago, but he was the guitarist in the first David Letterman Most Dangerous Band in the World. He did loads of work with people like David Sanborn and the Brecker Brothers and Marcus Miller. And he also played on quite a lot of soul and R&B records, records by Chaka Khan. He's also on a, he's on Gaucho, the Steely Dan record. I think he plays on My Arrival. But yeah, he played on quite a lot of stuff, you know, all the usual jingles and the disco records and whatnot. There's loads of disco records that came out in the 70s which were featured his rhythm guitar prowess. Okay, guys, we'll see you next time. Have a great week.